Hello, everyone. I'm Seema. Today we have Vibin with us from HP. Hi, Vibin.
Hello, glad to be here.
Okay, so can you tell us a little more about HP and your use case?
Sure. So HP is one of the world's largest consumer device manufacturing companies, from PCs, laptops, printers. And this use case is about ink cartridge manufacturing and about getting data from the factory into this real-time pipeline system, right? So from manufacturing data into a real-time pipeline system where users can make use of it.
Okay, so I see a lot of interesting services out there, right?
Yeah, so this, like I showed, is the entry point into this whole system. Behind this is our manufacturing machines. It generates a lot of data during the manufacturing process. It comes into Kinesis, real-time streams come into Kinesis data streams. From here, we send it to a processing unit, which is a Lambda DynamoDB combination.
Okay.
We also have data from Kinesis data streams that is being saved into S3, right, for further processing later. Now, this real-time processing unit is, as you can see, it goes through multiple stages. So I've just shown one unit here, but basically what it does is this business logic return Lambda that saves data into DynamoDB. This then triggers the next Lambda. So these are daisy chained so that it forms multiple stages.
Okay.
Now, what do these stages do? The first stage basically parses the data.
Okay.
The second enriches it with reference data.
Okay.
And the third normalizes it so that, you know, data across multiple lines, they all speak the same data model language.
Okay.
So that's basically what it is. It's a chain of these units.
And how do you get to second stage from the first one or like follow up? Is there a trigger?
Yes. So when Lambda saves it to DynamoDB, it basically triggers it, which is DynamoDB streams.
Okay.
So the streams then call the next Lambda in the chain.
Okay.
And that does the second, enriching of data, for example, among other things. Saves it to DynamoDB, which calls the third and so on.
Okay, so these three blocks are part of your data pipeline. I see an additional Lambda there. What is that for?
These are auxiliary Lambdas. So these alone process the data and send it to the next stage, but we need other Lambdas. So it's a bunch of N Lambdas, basically, that take data from the data DynamoDB streams and then persist it to Aurora as a data store. For some other use cases, it persists it to Elasticsearch as well. And we also do send it to S3. So there are multiple Lambdas that accomplish this. And these three are the primary consumption areas for our business users.
Okay, so you again have that Lambda being triggered from your DynamoDB streams, and then your data being sent to Aurora and Elasticsearch.
That's right.
Any particular reason of using Aurora here and Elasticsearch?
So, well, this lends itself easy to be triggered from Lambda because Aurora serverless, we're using the serverless version, and the serverless has data APIs which Lambda can call.
Okay.
And so that's a big benefit. We don't need to worry about connection pooling and all for a system that scales up quite quickly. So Aurora Serverless was a perfect fit. And this is also for users who are more comfortable with SQL. You know, they might not be able to process data in S3 like data scientists do. So this is a view for those kind of users.
Okay.
Elasticsearch is more for real-time dashboards because if I need to know where my part is in the whole manufacturing lifecycle, this provides a good dashboard for users for those kind of things.
Okay. I also see some glue jobs and Athena there. What are those for?
Yes. So glue jobs are, so we do store data in bulk in S3.
Okay.
This is for later bulk processing by our data scientists and ML jobs. Now glue does is it's a scheduled glue job that bulk processes data in S3. So we have it on a 6-hourly to a daily basis. So this processes data, saves it in S3, and this is being used by users. You know, so there's an Athena layer on top of S3.
Okay.
So it's again SQL over S3 data for users who actually need to access the data in S3.
Okay, so they can write the doc queries and get some data sets.
That's right.
Okay, that's interesting. And was this your original choice, or you explored any other options?
Well, no. Our original choice was it was a real-time platform, but we were using Kafka and Apache Storm.
Okay.
Kafka was the ingestion portion of things, and Apache Storm was a real-time events engine. But we found after some time of operation that we had to spend a lot of resources in just maintaining the environment. It was not managed.
Okay.
We were doing the managing.
So there were a lot of administration
issues. Correct. And this being a managed environment, it was easier for us to focus on the business logic then.
Okay. Any key learnings that you can share with us?
Yes. for example, DynamoDB, you know, we sometimes might go crazy in stringing a lot of Lambdas to DynamoDBs, but that's not a good option. You have to limit it to two or three, otherwise you might end up throttling DynamoDB reads.
Okay.
So best practices is limited to two or three. In terms of managing Lambdas also, at the time of our development, Lambda came up with a new feature called concurrent batches per shard.
Okay.
What that enables us to do is for each shard, we could invoke multiple Lambdas, thereby increasing the parallelism factor. For a system like this, what we need is more parallelism, more throughput. And so we got almost a 10 times increase in parallelism when we enable that feature. As well as, you know, you need to also tune your batch sizes. Not going with the default always isn't the best option. So tune your batch sizes according to your business use cases, and you might see that your throughput is increased a lot.
Okay, so I think pipeline and then modularization of Lambdas,
yes.
That's some of the key things that you explored.
That's
nice.
Right.
I think very interesting. I really enjoyed listening to it, and I hope our audience as well. Thank you. Thank you for watching. This is My Architecture.